Hello and welcome to an all-new episode of Sam Splains the World. I'm your host, Samantha Bremekamp. And on today's episode, one of the many things we're going to cover is how to propagate indeterminate tomato plants. Stick them, those suckers, which you'll hear all about, in water so that they can start growing roots. Now, when the roots are a couple inches, that's when I'll plant them in dirt, so that I can have endless tomatoes well into the fall. And they make great gifts. But Marmalade and I are going to show you a bunch of stuff, so sit back, relax, get comfortable, have a good snack, and kick off your weekend here on BCTV.
Hi, super excited to share with you in the garden. If you plant an indeterminate tomato, you can get a billion brand new tomato plants throughout the season as long as you pinch off the suckers, which I'm going to show you as part of this episode. Super excited. You're going to love it. And then you get endless tomatoes all summer. So just get ready for it.
Just going to point out, in an indeterminate tomato, suckers grow between the main branch or main stem and a regular branch, and then it becomes its own plant. So what you're going to do is get on in here and just snap it off. It's that easy. You're going to stick this in water, and then roots are going to form, and you're going to have a brand new tomato plant.
And it's important to pluck these so that all of the energy can go to the main tomato plant, and it doesn't get split up. See, the main tomato plant already has flowers started, which means it's going to be producing tomatoes, and we want all of the energy to go to that instead of sharing the love with everyone else. Gorgeous day for gardening.
So now that we have these suckers that we took off of our indeterminate tomatoes, we are now going to do something super difficult and complicated. I'm just kidding. We're just going to stick it in water. That's all you have to do. And then these suckers that are usually a nuisance will then sprout roots fairly quickly, and then you're able to plant them immediately once they have really good rootage coming out, and those become brand new tomato plants. So you could easily share them, or you could plant them, and that way you continue to have new tomato plants that just keep giving you tomatoes through the fall. It's so easy. This is how many I picked off that other day. And I have them in a giant vase. These are all suckers that have been between the main stem and regular branches of the indeterminate tomato plants. So now we sit and wait. I keep adding water to it, and yes, every now and again, I will rinse it out if it starts to get slimy or gross in there. If you notice the end of a tomato plant is slimy, chop it to about half an inch above where it got slimy to give it a better shot. Not all of them will make it, but they're free plants, so it doesn't really matter. Some of them will, and depending on how much you want to be able to be making and saving for sauce or canning, jarring for the winter or for gifts or whatever, it's up to you. You can make one, you can make endless. The best part about gardening is that you get to decide, and it could not be easier. And anybody can do it of any age. It's so much fun. So I was really pumped, and I wanted to give you an update on those tomato suckers that we plucked from the indeterminate, just to show you that they're starting to actually, it's a little soggy, sprout roots, which is awesome. Not all of them yet, but a lot of them. And that's pretty quick turnaround. I see those there. If I pluck these suckers, now it's on nursery rhyme, on Friday, and it's been about 4 days and it's sprouted roots, which is exciting. The roots aren't big enough for me to plant them in soil yet, but it's getting there. And I'm super confident that some of these will definitely take. The cool thing is that suckers will continue to grow. And if you let them grow big enough, they're more substantial and have a better chance of, you know, becoming their own full-blown tomato plant. But I can totally tell that at some point I'm just going to start plucking in them, even if they're little, because I'm not going to need 800 billion tomato plants that I'm aware of. But it's pretty cool to have the option. So. Ah, nature, you beautiful, beautiful creature. Looking forward to hearing all about your success with your garden, with dealing with suckers, and how big your bounty of tomatoes will be this year. I don't know about you, but fall is probably one of my absolute favorite times of year, Halloween especially. And in particular, I'm a huge sucker for caramel apples rolled in nuts. And I have discovered the ultimate hack to making a snack like that at home, which won't kill your teeth. Because, you know, we're adults, so we're playing for keeps. And if you have kids, they're going to love this too. And it's really not that bad for you. You're going to need an apple. My preference is something more tart to go along with what I'm going to be adding to it. And then I'm going to cut it up. Ooh, look at that. What am I, an artist? Wow, amazing. And then the secret ingredient, caramel dip with chunky peanut butter. You put them together and it becomes like that outside coating of the caramelized apple or a caramel apple that's rolled around in nuts. However, it doesn't break your teeth. It's much softer consistency. And it's pretty good for you because it's peanut butter, which has protein. Well, let me show you how it's done. Obviously, as you are the captain of the kitchen, you can put as much as little as you want. But this is just for me. So I'm just going to put a little amount because I'm recording this. And I don't want to look like I'm someone who eats too much. You know what I mean? Just kidding. You eat as much as you want because who cares in the end? Oh, yeah. Peanut butter, caramel. You're going to marry them on the plate. Yes, get together. Oh, you guys always belong together. It is so delicious and it's addicting. And it's awesome snack too, to bring to work or pack in your kids' lunch boxes if they don't have allergies, if you don't have allergies. But and it's even better than the ones that you can only get around Halloween time. I'll let you go so I can finish this in peace without making a fool of myself, but it's never stopped me before. Highly recommend. Super delicious, super easy. Three ingredients. Make snack time fun, you know? For adults, for kids, for guests. Press your family. Secret recipe you can hand down for generations. Whatever you want. Because you're the captain. And you know what pairs really well with delicious quiche? Lemonade, but not just any lemonade. I like to make ginger turmeric lemonade. I also like to put tea in it because I'm a huge Arnold Palmer fan. For those that don't know what that is, it's mixing iced tea with lemonade, putting them together. So what I like to do is by taking my home concoction of a tea that I put together, which I'll go over in a second, and boiling it down with turmeric and ginger, which have a lot of great medical benefits, but they also just taste really good. And lemons, or if you are like me today and do not feel like making fresh lemonade, you can just get lemonade and add that later on. Because you're going to be cooking the tea part of it with the agave, with the turmeric, with the ginger for a while and letting that all steep in. And then it's cooling down. And then you're going to pour lemonade and the concoction over ice that's already cooled down to mix to your taste. And then you will have the perfect icy lemonade monster that you are creating. A tip that I highly recommend. Of course, you're going to need maybe a peeler or a knife. Turmeric makes a really awesome color that stains everything. It'll be on your fingers forever. If it gets on your clothes, forget about it. So I like to just cut it down to chunks and putting it right into this little grinder that's meant for like nuts or coffee grounds or whatever that I've never used it for. But I do use it for this, and you can tell because this is now yellow. A yellowy orange from the turmeric, because that's what I use it for. You can do it however you want. You can wear gloves. You could put it directly in here. You could use a grater or shred it or whatever you want to do. I just don't like getting that color staining everything all over my hands. Control issues, sure, but also fashion. It's not a good color for me specifically. So taking the tea that has mint, lemon balm, lemon verbena, lemongrass, chamomile, rose petals, hops. Am I missing anything else? Nope, that's it. You could, of course, add black tea if you want to have caffeine in it. I don't. I make a big batch of this, and I like to be able to drink it at any time. So for me, my body can't handle caffeine after like lunchtime. If you're one of those people who can have caffeine 24/7, by all means, add real black tea or whatever, green tea, white tea, to get that caffeine kick, which will add another flavor layer to it. And for those that are so pure like me and can't do caffeine past noon, stick with the herbal stuff. Fresh garden supplies, like the mint or whatever, is great. This is all dried because I had put it all together over the winter, or for the winter, I should say. So it just depends on what you like and what you have. You do not have to add all of these things. You could just do like a Lipton iced tea bag or whatever kind. Bigelow, I don't know what you grew up on, but there's lots and lots of tea out there. So if you'd rather use that, by all means, please do. But adding the different flavors, like ginger and turmeric, just really livens it up, and it's really supposed to be really good for you. Not a teaologist, not a turmeric doctor or anything, but the interweb said it once, and I don't know if I believe them. I just know it tastes good. So that's why we're here. I'm not trying to get you to subscribe to anything for medicine, because I'm not a doctor in any capacity, and I do not play one on TV. So, okay, put this on the stove. We're going to boil it. It depends on how big of a pot or vat you want to make of it. I'm just making a little bit for me. I don't know if my partner's going to like it. So I just put in 4 cups and I'm going to chop this down, put it in here. I'll take you through the steps, and then you'll see me enjoy it at the very end. The turmeric, I just rinsed it off a little bit. I'm not going to peel the skin off of it. You can if you want to. That's up to you. I've done it. I used to do it like where you'd like it, really put in way too much effort. When in the end, it's going to boil down anyway. It doesn't really matter. So now I'm going to just put it into easier chunks that will fit in the little grinder. What a strong smell. It's like a beautiful orange color that I want to stay off of me and concentrate into this. I'm not going to put too much in it. One full one will be enough for me. And then I'm going to take a part like this. I got the tiniest ginger they had at the grocery store. So I'm going to take the big toe sized one and node. And I'm going to cut it off, and I'm going to make it a little bit smaller too. Ginger is very tough. It has lots of what feels like strings through it, which makes it stronger. So I'm going to throw it in with the turmeric into the grinder, but you can do it however you want. The smell is so good. I especially like to make this in the fall and winter. I feel like it helps me feel better. Maybe it's just like the color and the fact that it's like a lemonade, and that just makes it happier. And the agave I put in last. I just add it to taste for sweetening. You can use honey if you want. For some reason, I found that agave makes it better. I'm not usually a bigger honey person, but this I use agave. You can just use honey or whatever you want, or nothing if you don't like sweetener. It's fine. Or if you're growing stevia, a natural sweetener in your garden, then take a leaf or half a leaf and add it in. A little goes a long way with the stevia plant. It's really fun. It tastes immediately like sweetener. So a little goes a long way. And it's really easy to grow. But that's if you want to do it, if you want to add that to your garden. So now I'm going to make a loud sound and blend this all up. I'm going to add it to the pot that already has all of the herbs that are dry that I've put together. And we're going to let it boil for a little while. And that's it. It's so easy. We will strain it, of course, before you pour it into glasses. And we're going to have it cool down, and then I'm going to add the lemonade to it. But in the past, if you're using real lemons, which you totally can if you don't want to do this, add the lemon after it's cooled down. When you heat up a lemon, the flavor compound changes. For me, I like it better when it's not heated up, unless it's in like a hot tea because your throat hurts or something, but it changes it. I prefer cold lemon, but that's up to you. Just my advice. I've done it a bunch of times and tried it a bunch of different ways, and I found that I like that better. So I brought the pot back over. This is ground enough. Look at that gorgeous color. When you're scraping it out of your grinder, if you're using that, you can also use a blender. Just understand that the staining may occur. I almost grabbed a white silicone spatula to scrape it out, which is like a go-to. But I realized like this would absolutely stain it. So I'm getting a metal spoon, which will not take on anybody's color. And I'm adding it directly into the pot that already has the dried herbs that I've put in. Once I get most of it out, I soak it for a while. I know you can't tell because it's such a dark or a deep bright orange. But that's because I do this a lot. So it's just kind of taking heat over and over again, regardless of how well it's doing it. So remember, it stains, don't get mad. Not the biggest deal, but I don't want you getting upset. Definitely don't do this if you're wearing white and you want to keep that white, unless you're going to be able to bleach it later. And if you just got your nails did, put on gloves to save that manicure, because that costs so much money. It costs so much money to be a girl. Okay. Now that we have this already, finally you can smell this. I'm going to put it on the stove. I'm going to boil it. I don't know. For about 7 minutes, I'd say, once it gets to a boil. And then I'm going to reduce the heat, simmer it, and then take it off the heat and let it cool down for quite a while before I pour it in with the lemonade over ice. I'm very excited. Oh, this smells so good. Okay, here we go. So that was really quick. You wouldn't want to really boil it or steep it for longer than 10 minutes. But I don't know if you can see, it's this beautiful color. You see all the steam, my glasses are getting fogged up. Always happens. And it smells absolutely scrumptious. And before it cools down, I'm going to add the agave. Again, if you'd rather honey, which I usually prefer honey over everything, I totally get it. But add it now, because if you go to add it when you have ice and everything's cold, the honey is just going to solidify and sink to the bottom or stick to the ice or whatever, and it's not going to sweeten it like you need it to. I'm just doing a fine ribbon through it, and the lemonade that I bought, it's a, you know, Nature's Promise. It's organic lemonade. It's made with real sugar. None of those knockoff kinds, but it has its own little sweetener. So I'm just doing this to offset the strong flavoring of the turmeric and then ginger. A little goes a long way. And remember, you have to wait for this to cool, or you can drink it hot right now if you want. But that's up to you, and understand you're going to burn yourself, so maybe don't do it. But I can't wait to show you the delicious finished product, which as soon as this cools down, will be any second now. One of the things that I like to do is to strain it. I don't want to get a bunch of stuff that's going to get stuck on the bottom or come up through a straw if that's how I'm going to drink it. So I'm going to use a ladle and a tea strainer. Obviously, if you have a bigger one or one that sits on a cup, that'd be easier. But this is what I have, and we're going to see how well it does. Okay. I just want to show you and demonstrate like what it's going to look like with the finished product, so you don't have to wait forever. And yes, some of the things got through the strainer, but okay. I'm going to live. We're going to make it after all. I'm probably going to go out to the garden. Oh, it's so pretty. And get a fresh sprig of mint to stick in just for looks. But it's delicious. I'm so excited. It's so good. Definitely give it a try. Let me know what you think. And if you want to change up or add anything else to it, I could totally see adding like cranberry juice or pomegranate juice, making it look like a sunset. It's whatever you want it to be. Boy, is it delicious. Time for the much waited upon tomato update. Look at those roots. Ooh, girl. So this tomato friend is almost ready to get thrown into dirt, into the wild, to see if it survives. Slash, it will survive, because I'm gonna make it survive, despite the heat wave. And yeah, they're doing a great job. Everyone's looks great. Also, it's a really great centerpiece. I know it's like a bizarre thing. I don't know if you're like me, but you love the smell of tomato leaves. It's just fun, it's fresh, and you have it in abundance in your garden likely, so why not make it a centerpiece? Simply because you can, you know, defy norms. Sorry, Norm, but make your own little centerpiece. And if you want, you can let people take it home. Little reverse hostess gift from the soiree you're throwing in your backyard. Or be like Gollum and just keep everything because you can. It's up to you guys. Thanks for stopping by. May your tomatoes be ever plentiful. Have you ever tried to grow an avocado from a pit? I have countless times, and sometimes you get a sprout, but the best way that I have found is to take a pit, or a bunch of pits if you're really into avocado like I am, and you just soak it in water next to the sink for a really long time, until it finally splits open. Because in the very center of this pit is the actual seed, which is soft. So nestled inside. And when you split it open, you're able to gingerly get the seed out. The seed is teeny tiny and looks like this. So what I do, because as we know, I like to experiment, I'll just take it and stick it in this soil that I have in the kitchen. It's where I started to propagate one of the string of pearls that is taken, which is great. But this, my friends, is what happens a few weeks after you bury that seed. As it gets bigger, I'll try to transition it to outside because it's summer now. However, I don't know, but it's fun to try. And that's why I like to do a bunch of these every time. I just save it just to see. And so I will. How cool would it be, by the way, to have an avocado tree? Pretty awesome. The odds of it taken in our climate, I don't know. But if you are able to bring it in over winter, then why not try? Because that would be so cool. And then you'll be able to save on a down payment for a mortgage. Just kidding. That's not how finances work. But I, Avoca, do suggest you do this, if you're into it. Oh, what's that behind me, you're wondering? It's a good question. Remember those tomato suckers? We keep getting more of them. And it looks like a beautiful bouquet. And they're starting to really take root. But not until the roots are a few inches long while I then stick it into the soil because you want them to have the best chances of surviving. But like, look how giant some of them are getting. It's really fun. Experimenting is fun. As the heat rises and we're kind of stuck indoors, you can still do things like propagating, getting up super early to do all the outside stuff, and then coming inside and playing with your avocado seeds. You know, or other things. You can have Netflix or whoever on in the background. Look at that beautiful seed. Oh, so much fun. One of these days, it's really going to take. Nope, this one doesn't want to let go. And that happens. That's why it's okay if you do a bunch of them. Because then you're not going to be as sad if like the one seed that you finally got didn't take. You're going to say, oh, well, I have like six of these. Anyway. Can't wait for this to grow so I can finally put it on my toast. Live up to my age. Well, anyway, thanks for stopping by this all over the place episode of Sam Splains the World with your host, Samantha Bremekamp, co-host Marmalade, and a bunch of things that I hope you take something from. And if you don't, that's okay. Thanks for coming in anyway. Kicking off your weekend, the little quiet Sam Splains, little quiet garden tour, anything to kick off your weekend. Thanks, BCTV, for hosting me.